previous video of chapter 3 gravitation we have learned about two more units of force. So I just want to recapitulate what are the units of force we have learned so far. This units SI unit Newton, 1 Newton is 1 kg into 1 meter per second square, because just follow the simple F is equal to M into A, force is equal to mass into acceleration. So we can get units of force from Newton's second law of motion. So 1 Newton is 1 kg meter per second square, and dyne is a CGS unit. So 1 dyne will be 1 gram into 1 centimeter per second square. Okay. Relation between Newton and dyne, we have got 1 Newton is equal to 10 to the power 5 dyne, and these are the gravitational units of force. Gravitational units of force, which I have just done in the previous video lesson from chapter 3e, KGF and GF. What is the relation between KGF and Newton? KGF and Newton, 1 KGF is 9.8 Newton, and GF and dyne, 1 GF is 980 dynes. Okay? All the units are very important. Okay? So please be very much confident in the units. Next, we will start with the free fall, the last topic from 3E. Okay. Remember the three equations of motion, Newton's equations of motion, which we have learned. V is equal to u plus at, where suppose a body is moving with initial velocity u, force is being applied, it has been accelerated by acceleration a in time t, final velocity after time t, v. Similarly, you have other two equations, v square equal to u square plus 2as. What is s? The distance covered. We have another equation relating distance, s is equal to ut plus half at square. Now, so displacement s is equal to ut plus half at square. So these three equations of motion we have already done. Now, suppose if I release a marker, it will fall under no other force, rather except for the force of gravity acting on it, for which the acceleration produced will be g. We have already read about this, studied about this. So, and by the concept free fall, we mean that when a body falls freely under the force of gravity, considering that no air friction is being acting on the body, which is falling. Okay, the simplest case of free fall. So, now let's see how these equations of motion change when we apply free fall to a body. That is when a body falls freely under gravity. When it falls freely under gravity, acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity. When a body falls down, g is taken as plus g. Okay? So, when a body is falling down, g is plus. Because the velocity is increasing, rate of change of velocity, rate of increase in velocity, that's why. Now let's see how the equations change. V is equal to u plus gt. See, in the place of a, I'm substituting g, because now g is my acceleration due to gravity. V square equal to u square plus 2gh. V square equal to u square plus 2gh. H is nothing but the height. It's falling, say, from this height to the ground. H is the height. Okay? We just use H in place of S. Okay? H is equal to the height which is traveling. That is equal to ut plus half gt square. Gt square. Done? Now, when the body is falling, initially, what if it is at rest? U equal to 0. Initial velocity 0. Then how will the equations change? Just remember this. This you can automatically understand. If you remember, if you know by initial velocity 0, that means U equal to 0. You don't need to memorize this. Just remember the forms. That means V will become GT, V square will become 2GH, H will become half GT square. Special case of this. Now, when a body is thrown vertically upward, in place of A, we will substitute minus G. Now the acceleration is minus G. V is equal to U minus GT. In place of plus, in place of A, if I substitute minus G, obviously it will become U minus GT. V square equal to U square plus 2 into, in place of A, I am substituting minus G. So minus 2G H. H again, you know, the height instead of S, we are writing H. The height traveled, I am just throwing the marker upward, the height it will travel. H is equal to UT minus, again see, UT plus half in place of A minus G T square. So, done. This is how the equation starts. Now, when I throw a marker upwards, say I am just throwing the marker upwards, the maximum height it will reach, that is known as H max. At the maximum height, velocity will be zero, because all the energy has been transferred to potential energy, okay? No kinetic energy now. So, at the maximum height, velocity, the final velocity is zero. Now see how these equations, a special case of these equations, at the maximum height, V is zero, U is equal to GT. If V is zero, U is equal to GT. Next one, V is zero, U square equal to 2GH. U square equal to 2GH max. Because in the maximum height. Okay, so can I write H max as U square by 2G? Obviously, I can write this from here. See, H max is equal to U square by 2G. What about this one? H max is equal to UT minus half GT square. This will remain same, no change, because we don't have V here in this form. So, this will just remain as it is. So, if I have to calculate the H max and I know the initial velocity, which one will I use? This one. Because if I know this, and G is always constant 9.8, or you can use 10. So, if I know this, this is 0 at the maximum height, I can calculate H max from this equation. H max is equal to U squared by 2G. Okay? So, just remember the forms. If you remember this, you will remember this and this. It's nothing, we are just substituting. And special cases will automatically, you will be, you know, fluent enough if you just practice the numericals, okay? So, we'll do numericals and we'll be, you know, much more fluent in all this. Okay. So, that's all for the topic, chapter 3.